How are diaspora subjects, narratives and related anxieties expressed and highlighted in transnational filmmaking? How is the storytelling, the imagery and film aesthetics, camera work, sound, editing, used to convey symbolic narratives and themes such as exile, migration and post-colonial gazes? To discuss this question in depth, we're going to be investigating three transnational texts: Lehane, 1995, Dirty Pretty Things, 2002 and Last Resort, 2001. The first of the three transnational texts, Lehane, is set in France and is directed by French director Mathieu Kassovitz. Each protagonist is a second-generation diaspora subject, but the film mostly focuses on Vince's struggle with his identity. There is a very clear empathetic understanding around Vince's character, and this could be a result of the director having a Jewish father and being born in Paris. Dirty Pretty Things can be classified as transnational outside of the plot due to the cast being from France, Spain and Croatia. This provides a range of different cultural insights that may have brought more understanding about diaspora to the film. Finally, Last Resort, which inherits transnational insights as a result of the Polish director Paweł Pawlikowski working alongside British screenwriter Roman Joff. The two main protagonists are from Russia and have claimed that they are refugees in order to get into the UK. We will be discussing how the subjects in the three films all, through their migration and exile that they face as individuals, begin to show signs of identity loss, alienation and exile. We are first introduced to Vince by his dream. This alone already shows his loss of identity. In addition to this, his clothes and environment are very different to the dancing and music. It shows a clear juxtaposition between the projects and traditional Jewish practices. Leschitzky suggests that the character of Vince represents a new image of a diasporic Jew, a character not only limited by the traditional stereotypes of Jew in Western culture, but also by the vulnerability of the Jewish community post-Holocaust. Vince is not the stereotypical Jewish character we might expect. He is weak and defenceless to the society that continues to reject him, just as the Jewish community has been continually exiled through history, most notably the Nazi regime. We are shown later in the film that this is the same location he hides a gun. This location could be both a literal and metaphoric hiding place. It is to hide the gun, but it also hides his identity. Immediately after his dream, Vince is called a Jew boy, followed quickly by "You bogus kike, you're nowhere," by his friend Saeed. This instantly shows the audience that Vince is struggling with his identity. His friend goes from calling him a Jew boy to a bogus kike in a matter of seconds. A kike is an insulting way to call someone Jewish, therefore a bogus kike would be a fake Jew. It is no doubt then that Vince is having identity issues as a direct result of being a second generation diaspora subject who is losing his grasp of his family's religion. We drew similarities between this and Shanae from Dirty Pretty Things, in which she progressively loses touch with her identity, which can be also seen as her losing touch with her God. In the beginning of the film, Shanae is poised with her hair tied back neatly and her morals set in stone. Throughout the film, we see a gradual deterioration in Shanae's behaviour and characteristics. We believe this to be a gradual loss of her identity. Here we see Shanae being sexually assaulted by her boss in a small enclosed area with no escape. With knowledge that she is a virgin because of her religion, the callousness of the act is intensified. This inevitably leads to an adjustment of character for Shanae, as the second time she's assaulted, she bites back. However, this quickly changes when she experiences a breakdown whilst on the phone to Oakway. She is entrapped in the phone box, exposed by the four windows surrounding her. The tone is dark. This conflicts with the next scene that we see Shanae. The tone is bright and the music is loud and repetitive, suggesting the connotation of Shanae being emotionally reborn due to her giving up hope. The camera pans from Shanae's feet upwards to her face to resemble the new identity, new beliefs and new behaviour. Her eyes are shut to suggest her trance-like state of freedom. Showing Shanae dancing like this immediately after the phone box scene denotes a clear juxtaposition and highlights the huge identity struggle that she is going through. It is clear that Shanae feels she has to form a new identity as she has lost touch with her God.
I will need a pill.
Within the book Diaspora, Identity and Religion, it is suggested when discussing diaspora, it is maintained by reference to construct or common language, history, culture and central to many cases, religion. By this, we can see evidence of the importance of an individual's religion in relation to the feeling of belonging.
In Nigeria, they do many interesting things with pork. But of course, I use lamb.
Shanae's character, having been sexually assaulted on three occasions before beginning to lose her religious beliefs, indicates that she has accepted that she cannot simultaneously dedicate to her religion whilst also living and working illegally in London.
What would your God say?
My God does not speak to me anymore.
Rowell argues that Sinead's sexual assault represents the invisibility migrants have in society, often vulnerable to economic and sexual exploitation. Through Frere's employment of the thriller genre, he is suggesting that immigrant groups have the potential power to reject their invisible identity. However, it is still clear that being a Muslim in London is not the zeitgeist and challenges the character she has to be to fit in. In this next scene, a song is played which floods the projects with sound. The lyrics read, "Fuck the Police," which is sampled from the Beastie Boys and KRS-One, both of which are American artists. Edith Piaf's famous "Je ne regrette rien" is then mixed in, which creates a mockery of French culture. Perhaps the residents of the projects are now rejecting French culture just as the French have rejected them. When looking at Dirty Pretty Things and Last Resort, we see a contrast to this. We see clear examples of the characters attempting to embrace their new country's culture as opposed to rejecting it. The biggest difference between these three films is that both Dirty Pretty Things and Last Resort show the lives of first-generation diaspora subjects. These subjects may be more willing to embrace the culture because of their illegal refugee status, using it as a cover or mask to present themselves as a normal British citizen. Whereas in La Haine, the second-generation subjects are established in their country yet are disillusioned with their status. They are less willing to embrace a culture that they may have grown up in, but that continues to oppress and reject them. Looking back at the aesthetics in La Haine, this scene shows a camera crew who are looking for interviews with rioters. They are filmed in a much higher position than the three men, a traditional filmmaking technique which connotes the crew's position of power over the men relating to class. When the reverse shot of the three men is shown, the background is dominated by the projects, emphasising the poor socio-economic location, particularly in contrast to the higher class journalists and their expensive equipment. This technique shows selective process of filming the men for news. The cameraman is only interested in capturing them at their most violent. This is part of the problem of identity as it relates to misrepresentation of minorities through a media bias where ethnic minorities are demonised in the press. For example, the migrant crisis has been negatively represented in the press, referring to them as terrorists and criminals, all due to the fact they are crossing borders. The film Last Resort also tackles issues to do with migrants and refugees and how they are treated when coming to the UK. Similarly to La Haine, they are not given the chance to represent themselves and are often treated like animals. The filmmaker creates a symbolic narrative using imagery and film aesthetics to convey themes of exile and migration. The film begins with Tanya and Artyom physically crossing a border. They travel from Russia to England. This introduces how the movement changes the identity of the characters. The respect and status they had in their homeland is diminished and they are treated like criminals instantaneously. This scene is reminiscent of a mugshot and paints the picture that Tanya is a criminal. Grey skies, fences, barbed wire, sirens and police dogs barking always confront them. The treatment of refugees in the UK has consistently been an issue. Lizzie Dearden, reporter for The Independent, explained, "Refugees arriving from war zones or who are fearful of police because of their experiences at home are distressed and confused by the procedure, which many try and avoid. We are shown images of security cameras backed up by a constant reminder of the train tracks, which the refugees cannot use, increasing the tension surrounding entrapment. We can relate all these anxieties and imagery back to the real refugee crisis. For example, journalist Toby Melville describes the immigration removal centres as proper prisons, with despicable conditions such as lack of medical care, physical abuse and illegal indefinite detentions. This again is why the film is shot in a documentary style, to plant these stories in the real world, because they are evident issues that we are still dealing with today. To conclude, we have pinpointed a few major anxieties for the diasporic characters and have explored how the filmmaker communicates this to the audience.
Hello? Police? Yeah, got somebody wants to talk to you.
We found that when characters migrate, they question their identity. This is because their culture and values are often rejected and other cultural norms are pushed upon them.
You stay here too long. You start dressing like an Englishman.
We found diaspora is represented differently between first and second generation characters as they battle very different anxieties and issues. We examine current social issues such as treatment of refugees and their misrepresentation in the media. We also found the director's personal experience had an influence in their storytelling, especially as each one of them has suffered their own diasporic anxieties. All three films have completely different aesthetics yet successfully display a complex acknowledgement of the diasporic issues linked with identity, exile and migration, and succeed in the aim to educate the audience in a somewhat understated subject that is now more relevant than ever.